Welcome one and all again formally to the 68th graduation ceremony of the Fay Jones School of Architecture and Design. My name is Peter MacKeith. It's my pleasure on behalf of our students, our faculty, and our staff to welcome you to the Faulkner Performing Arts Center, which has served as a home for so many events for the university over many years, but certainly once upon a time as a home for programs in architecture, landscape, architecture, and interior design, and more latterly has been converted into this fine facility through the design talents of our own alumni. While our faculty are standing here in front, I'd like for them to turn to the audience and receive your applause for their care and concern and their attention to our students' education. Thank you. Please be seated. As we begin, I will look back in time just a very few hours earlier this morning in the Walton Arena. We celebrated the graduation of over 4,600 university graduates at all levels of degree programs. We also awarded two honorary degrees, each of those individuals important in their own way to today's ceremonies. The first is a man named Al Bell. And if you do not know Al Bell, he figures prominently, perhaps in all of our emotional histories attached to music, especially American music from the 1950s forward. He was at one point the CEO of Stax Music in Memphis, responsible for so much, I think, for many of us, of our teenage and adult memories. It is so that we heard a superb rendition during those ceremonies of a fantastic song that he produced, performed by the University Soul Band, but originally performed by the Staples Singers, called I'll Take You There. So I hope that song is in your head, if it can be, because we are certainly here now at an important moment in these young people's lives, to celebrate their lives thus far and to celebrate their futures, and certainly to celebrate all of you who have contributed so much to bringing them to this present point. The second person who we recognized this afternoon or this morning is one of our own alumni. In fact, Chris Hinton Lee is the first African-American woman to graduate from the Fay Jones School of Architecture and Design. And she went on to an illustrious career in the Army Corps of Engineers, overseeing many, many responsibilities for the United States and for those who serve the United States near and far. I'll refer back to Chris as we come to a close this afternoon. But those two wonderful people would not be here were it not for the invitation of our Chancellor, who joins us today, a great privilege, Chancellor Joseph Steinmetz, who has been a supporter of architecture and design as soon as he arrived, and continues to look forward with us as a school to further endeavors in resiliency design, community design, housing design, design writ large across the built environment, not only of Arkansas, but of the nation. And I'd like to ask Chancellor Steinmetz to give us a few words of welcome and thoughts as we begin this afternoon, and thank him as he comes, all one and all, for his support to the school.
Thank you, Dean MacKeith. And it's really, really, truly an honor to be here today. We have a robust program, I saw it, so I'll keep my remarks very, very brief, and that's probably for the thankfulness of everybody that's here, as well as everybody up here. I want to begin by extending my congratulations to this year's Fay Jones School graduate, as well as any family members who may be joining them here today. I'm sure that earning your degree means as much to them as it does to you. And I'm excited about your futures. As design professionals and design thinkers, your work will be instrumental in solving some of the big issues and challenges we face as a society. For example, a climate that's changing, a scarcity of affordable and attainable housing around our country, that's another thing I think about. And these provide opportunities to put into practice all of the things that you've learned here. You've been uniquely trained to make our future a better one, and as you move forward beyond your campus home and go into the world, it is you who I know can make some very big changes. It's you who will conceive of innovative and ways to promote, to preserve, and protect the built and our natural environments. It's you who will create the spaces and the structures that are needed for affordable housing for our families. It is you who will explain and help others understand the ways that design can improve their daily lives. And it's you who will step forward to lead and advocate for change in the places where you work and in the places where you live. It is all of you who will train and educate the next generation while working in collaborative ways with those generations before you. For all of this, I thank you now, and I'm looking forward to seeing your work in the coming years. Thank you, and enjoy today's commencement.
We have something of a tradition, if you call a five-year tradition a tradition, in the school of recognizing those who have come before on a 50-year and 25-year basis to, in a sense, try to contextualize ourselves, understand where we've come from so that we can better prepare ourselves for where we are going. The class of 1969 is displayed above, and about halfway down, or actually one-third of the way down the first column, you see the name John B. Dupree. We are privileged today to welcome John B. Dupree here, representing the Fay Jones School of Architecture and Design's class of 1969. Mr. Dupree, would you please stand and be recognized? As each of our graduates receives their diploma at center stage and proceeds on for further photographs, Mr. Dupree is also here to represent the Arkansas Alumni Association, and he will be presenting each of our graduates with their own alumni pin. We also want to look back 25 years, and there is the class of 1994. You can see the school growing numerically and in qualitatively over those 25 years. And in fact, this overflow audience today reflects a school continually growing in size and in programs. Just to note and to place us in one further context, at least musically, in 1969, the Grammy Awards provided that year recognized as both for song and male vocalist Otis Redding, sitting on the dock of the bay. And perhaps there's no such thing as coincidence, because that very song in 1969 was produced by Stax Music in Memphis, Tennessee, overseen by Al Bell. It's also so, if we think of other Arkansas representatives, musically speaking, from 1969, Johnny Cash received the Country Music Award for Folsom County Blues. I know a song fondly appreciated by Professor Blackwell in particular. And then lastly, or not lastly, but new artist of that year was Jose Feliciano, and his rendition of Light My Fire was Song of the Year. And in an Arkansas connection as well, the Album of the Year was performed by Glenn Campbell of Delight, Arkansas, By the Time I Get to Phoenix. So we are connected, and we will be connected, as I'll demonstrate in some further ways later on, but please understand that this is the context in which our students proceed. Now, with that, all of those songs perhaps in your mind, let's move forward in our program to some special recognitions, honors, awards, and a very special moment as well in the life of the school. To assist us all in that, I invite Associate Dean and Professor of Architecture Ethel Goodstein Murphy to the podium. Ethel.
Thank you, Dean McKeith. Good afternoon to one and all. Our very special guests, my dear colleagues on the faculty,
and most of all, our class of 2019, very unique and splendid group of individuals who will change America. To recognize some of the special achievements of our graduates, as well as to honor some among our group who have been absolutely
as a collective, where faculty, leadership, students, and staff work together. That will make the world better through design. First, I want to recognize those students, soon to be former students, among our graduates who have served the school admirably in their leadership of student organizations, a group of leaders among equals upon whom Dean McKeith and I turn frequently to understand how the school looks from the studio desk up. When I mention your name, please stand and we'll hold applause for when we have the entire group on their feet. Representing the American Institute of Architecture students, a young woman who served as its president, Mary Elizabeth Barden. Representing the student chapter of the American Society of Landscape Architects, Erin Cox. Representing the student chapter of the American Society of Interior Designers, one of its former presidents, Abigail Redman. A leader and founding member of our National Organization of Minority Architecture Students, Selwyn Backus. And a leader of our National Honor Society in Design, Tau Sigma Delta, Caleb Bertels. Please join me in acknowledging the good work, the goodwill, and good spirit. Last month, the Fay Jones School of Architecture and Design recognized the outstanding achievements of our students at our annual honors recognition reception. As is our custom, today we'll take the opportunity to honor these distinguished graduates once again. It falls to me to announce winners of all school awards. We'll hear from our department heads with the department recognitions in just a short while. So, please stand when your name is called. Since 1941, a key has been given to the graduating student in our school and in every unit on campus who earns the highest cumulative grade point average. That individual is our Fay Jones School Senior Scholar. This year's recipient is Caleb Bertels, who is receiving the Bachelor of Architecture degree. Caleb, please stand and be recognized. The Alpha Rho Chi Medal is awarded annually to the graduating student who has shown leadership ability, performed willing service to the school, and although this isn't in the description, I have to add, is the most creative, dedicated, and hardworking teaching assistant who has ever crossed the Fay Jones School's portals. This year's recipient of the Alpha Rho Chi Medal It's Rachel Christine Filgus receiving the Bachelor of Architecture. Rachel. The Tau Sigma Delta Medal is awarded annually to the graduating student with records of distinction in design in one of the subject areas of our school. This year's recipient is Erin Alicia Cox, receiving the Bachelor of Landscape Architecture. Erin. We have a special honor this year of recognizing one student in our graduating class who has been honored at the university level. The university honors this year 71 students selected from more than 500 nominations representing each University of Arkansas undergraduate academic college with a recognition entitled The Senior of Significance. From this already stellar group, selected on the basis of academic achievements, leadership skills, and extracurricular campus and community activities, is a very distinguished group, representing the top 11 female and top 11 male graduating seniors of the University of Arkansas for the academic year. This esteemed group is the Razorback Classics. For our school, we take such pride in the recognition of Colt Malloy, Bachelor of Architecture, who has been recognized as... Let me finish! Down! Razorback Classics, Senior of Significance. I can tell we have a rocking group with us this afternoon. Who knows what the day's proceedings will hold? Last but certainly not least, I would like to acknowledge our graduating seniors who are members of the Honors College and will graduate as Honors College Fellows. In so doing, I also want to give proper thanks and appreciation to my good colleague, Associate Professor Noah Billig, who is our school's Honors College Director. So Noah, why don't you please stand and show our Honors College students how to rise with dignity. Honors College grads, please stand to be recognized. All of y'all. There is one more special recognition that remains to be offered. In advance of celebrating our 2019 graduates, we have the bittersweet task of awarding a posthumous degree, the Bachelor of Architecture, to Andrea Torres. It is with a mixture of heavy hearts and good cheer that we welcome the many members of her family who will join us today to honor her memory. I invite Andrea's mother, Teofilia Arredondo, and her sister, Alondra Alexandre Arredondo, together with any other family members, to join Dean McKeith and the Chancellor at the podium as we remember Andrea. For those of you who didn't have the opportunity to make her acquaintance, Andrea was a first-year student who was just discovering her passion for architecture. As I got to know Andrea in our first-year experience class, it was apparent that she was a promising student, possessing a vibrant spirit and full of strong anticipation and hope for the opportunity to become an architect and through that opportunity to make the world a better place. We're grateful that she was part of our community, if only for a painfully short time. She will be remembered. May I ask you to join in a moment of silence in memory of Andrea Torres as we award her posthumous degree. Thank you. I know you join us in sharing a lot of love with Andrea's family. To continue with our ceremony, it's my pleasure to invite Ken McCowan, head of the Department of Landscape Architecture, to present his department's awards. Ken.
The Department of Landscape Architecture is a 9-semester program, and many of our students graduate in December of the 5th year of their time in the department. The first award for the Department of Landscape Architecture is the Verna C. Garvan Medal. The medal is for the senior student of landscape architecture who, through performance in the studio sequence, demonstrated outstanding design ability. This year's recipient is fall 2018 graduate Jacob Costello. If we could have a round of applause for him. The next award is the American Society of Landscape Architecture's Honor and Merit Awards from the State Chapter of Arkansas. These awards from the state's professional landscape architects recognize landscape architecture students in the final 2 years of study with high academic performance, design ability, self-motivation, and personal responsibility. It's a student career award for what they have done during their time in the Department of Landscape Architecture. This year's recipient of the Honor Award is fall 2018 graduate Jacob Costello, and the Merit Award recipient is fall 2018 graduate Ben McGee. That'll conclude the Department of Landscape Architecture Awards. Please welcome Carl Matthews, Department Head of Interior Design, to announce their department awards.
In 2019, the U.S. Congress passed the 19th Amendment, giving women the right to vote. 1919, sorry. What century am I in? Elsie DeWolf didn't wait for the men of Congress to validate her. 15 years before she was given the right to vote, she had the audacity to charge fees for interior design services. And it's with this audacity that all of our interior design students graduate and enter the profession. The Interior Design Department gives a book award for each year of our curriculum. They celebrate students with intellectual curiosity and high academic performance. First, second, and third year awards were represented at an earlier ceremony. The Interior Design Book Award for fourth year is presented to Hannah Johnson. Hannah? Our highest award of distinction is the Interior Design Medal of Excellence. It celebrates the first ranked final year interior design student for scholastic achievement, and we offer our heartiest congratulations to Abigail Redmond. And now, Head of Architecture Jeff Shannon will announce the Architecture Awards.
Thank you, Carl. As I call your name, please stand and be recognized. Our first award is for the American Institute of Architects Henry Adams Medal. This award recognizes the first-ranked graduate in the professional program of architecture for scholastic achievement. Character, leadership, and promise of high professional ability. This award's recipient is Caleb Bertels. I told him he had to sit down. The Edward Durell Stone Medal honors the memory of Stone, a Fayetteville native and an architect of international renown. The medal presented to the graduating student who has achieved the highest overall grade point average in design studio courses. This year's recipient is Caleb Bertels. The Barbara C. Crook Medal, a tribute to the late Professor Crook, is awarded to the student who presents the highest record of achievement in architectural technology classes. This year's recipient is Caleb Bertels. Sit down. The Marianne Van Rensselaer Medal distinguishes a senior student in architectural studies program who has achieved excellence in attaining a liberal education and focus on architecture and its allied discipline. This year's recipient, Mary Elizabeth Barden. The C. Murray Smart Medal recognizes excellence in the study of history and theory of architecture by the architecture graduate who has achieved the highest collective scholastic record in this course of study. This medal honors Murray Smart for his contributions to the school as dean and professor. This year's recipient is Anna Morris. Established in the memory of a respected family member, the Mortcart Medal is awarded to the fifth-year student who has exhibited the greatest concern for social, cultural, and behavioral issues as they relate to design. This year's recipient is Selwyn Backus. The John G. Williams Joy of Architecture Medal is awarded to the graduating senior who exhibits a devotion to the profession, a positive work ethic, and who demonstrates promise of professional success. This year's recipient is Colt Malloy. And I will invite the dean back. Peter.
Thank you, Jeff, Carl, and Ken, and congratulations to all of our honor award recipients. It may be no surprise that I will be introducing Caleb Bertels as our student speaker, but I am. The many accolades you've heard provided to Caleb speak volumes about his academic prowess. So do the many semesters that his name has graced both the Dean's List and the Chancellor's List, his recognition as our Presidential Scholar in 2016, and his leadership in the Tau Sigma Delta Honor Society. His work has been honored with awards for design excellence in the Comprehensive Design Studio and in the Fay Jones School Interdisciplinary Design Competition. At the same time, he served the school selflessly as a teaching assistant, a peer mentor, and a technical assistant preparing for exhibitions that presented the work of the school to regional and international audiences alike. You have seen Caleb rise gracefully with this year's distinguished cohort of Honors College Fellows. Indeed, we have high expectations of every single one of this remarkable group of students, and Caleb's capstone project, Decoding Third Places, contributes to the ever-growing legacy of strong and meaningful undergraduate research in the Fay Jones School. His unique combination of creativity and intelligence combined with a work ethic, which is intrinsic to every Fay Jones student, has fueled his growth as an emerging voice in design. He's begun his journey towards architectural practice with internships at Cushman & Wakefield, Breyer Architecture, and Polk Stanley Wilcox. Next month, his trajectory continues as he joins the firm of Heffer Wysocki in Leawood, Kansas, just outside of Kansas City. In summary, Caleb leaves the Fay Jones School with a great record of achievement and promise to influence the made world. He's a graduate in whom the school, the university, and his parents, Glenn and Dawn Bertels, who join us today, will take pride in for years to come. Ladies and gentlemen, our student speaker, Caleb Bertels, Bachelor of Architecture.
Thank you, Dean McKeith. I'll try to be brief because we have a lot of names to get through today, but it is an honor to be here to talk to you all about why we are here. More specifically, why this group of people is here. Over the last 5 years, I've had the privilege to work with and alongside these students, each with their own skills, interests, and very unique personalities. Their presence on this stage is a testament to the dedication, effort, and excellence they have demonstrated during their time at the Fay Jones School. And while we are gathered here to celebrate these efforts, we also recognize those who stayed with us during this time. None of us would be here had it not been for the support, encouragement, love of our families and friends. Mom, Dad, Ike, your help has meant more to me than you will know, just as I am sure my classmates all have those either here today or elsewhere that have molded them into the great people I know them to be. On behalf of all of us, I would like to thank you for always being there for us through all of our successes and failures. Additionally, it would be a mistake not to acknowledge the work of the Fay Jones faculty and staff. It is not an easy task preparing students to enter the real world of design. Believe me, I recently went through some of my initial work from the beginning of first year, and let's just say I'm very grateful to have learned a lot since then. But our professors stuck with us, offering their advice and experience. This commencement is just as much a celebration of their work and efforts as it is ours. We all had the chance to know them as mentors, colleagues, and in many cases, friends. And again, on behalf of the students, thank you for getting us to this stage today. And it is very fitting that we're having commencement in this very room. Like many of my classmates, my first interaction with the Fay Jones School was 7 years ago when Vol Walker Hall was still under renovation. The building was unfinished at this time, and this building was serving as home to many of the studios for the school. It was full of tables of trace paper and models and printouts, everything I expected from an architecture school and more. And among this chaos, I had the chance to talk with some of the faculty and students at the time. Everyone was so passionate about their work in the university, and it really seemed like the school wanted to create a positive impact on the world through design. I knew this is where I wanted to be, and although a lot's happened since then, this initial feeling has remained. The Fay Jones School has been very good to us. We've had the opportunity to study and even work in cities across the U.S. and abroad. We benefited from the knowledge of professionals in a range of disciplines through lectures, internships, and classwork. And we've all gotten to know one another, improving from each other's perspectives and insights, as well as becoming part of the community. And most importantly, we've had the chance to study the subject of design, which we love. We wouldn't have spent so many late nights in the architecture building if that hadn't been the case. Whether it's architecture, interior design, or landscape architecture, we've learned that design has the ability to generate emotions, address social issues, and bring people together. Our professors have always encouraged us to tackle these ideas in our lessons, looking at a bigger picture beyond our own professions. I've been continuously impressed with the high level of work and the amount of collaboration we've been exposed to over the last several years. It's important that you all know that when it comes to their work, my classmates are among the most dedicated and thoughtful students I've had the honor to work with. Their hard work is rivaled only by their character. When I moved to Arkansas 5 years ago, I didn't know a soul, And now I've made more friends and connections than I can count, some of which are even back here today to celebrate with us. I really do feel like I'm part of something bigger than myself. And that's what I'm most excited to see after graduation, where my classmates and I will go and all the great things I know we'll do. Some are returning to familiar communities with their new knowledge, seeking to make a difference by influencing the built environment. Others are moving to new, exciting places to make their own mark on the design profession. And still others are continuing to better themselves through additional education and travel. And to think that all of these possibilities began the day we first stepped into Volwalker Hall. Today is a time to remember all of these experiences and lessons that have led to this very moment. A time to celebrate among classmates, faculty, family, and friends. And a time to look ahead at what lies next. Whatever that may be, I'm confident that these graduates will continue to thrive, carrying on the level of excellence that our school is known for. So while we are here today to remember our time at the Fay Jones School of Architecture plus Design, remember that the best is yet to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Caleb. Now, the moment that you and you have all been waiting for, the awarding of degrees. Hear this carefully, awarding of degrees. We pick our words carefully, for your degrees have already been conferred by our Chancellor, Joseph Steinmetz, at the All-University Commencement Ceremony some hours ago. I will ask Ethel to join me at center stage for the actual awarding of degrees. I'll ask John Dupree to take the far end for the presentation of alumni pins, and we will proceed by department and discipline, landscape architecture first, interior design second, and our graduates in architecture and architectural studies third. So, with this in mind, I'll ask Ken McCown to begin the announcing of names. Graduates, you'll come here, hand your card off to Professor McCown, proceed to the center of the stage for the awarding of degrees.
Will the candidates for Bachelor of Landscape Architecture Studies and Bachelor of Landscape Architecture stand and approach the podium? You're ahead of the game. Bachelor of Landscape Studies, Dallas Myers. Bachelor of Landscape Studies, Casey Coffey. Bachelor of Landscape Architecture, Erin Alyssa Cox. I'd like to welcome the Red Shoe Team, led by Carl Matthews, head of an interior design.
The amazing people in red shoes have already joined me. Abigail Christine Redman. Camille Marie Castleberry. Heather Nicole Bly. Caroline Grace Elliott. Logan Chance Bakke. Lauren Elizabeth Osborne. Peyton Elizabeth Richards. Mary Ruth Murphy. Sarah Johnson. Amber Nicole Horton.
Lindsay Michelle Stedner. Alexandra Claire Bandy. Hannah Johnson. Lindsay Marie Huntsman. Hannah Elizabeth McCarley. Molly Jean Paris. Megan Carlton. Cheyenne Nayelidel Schrader. Now Jeff Shannon.
Will the candidates for Bachelor of Architectural Studies and Bachelor of Architecture please approach the podium? Kristen T. Rogers. Tristan Spears Thomas. Sarah Eleanor Green. Justice Raquel Barnes. Connor Payne. Mary Elizabeth Barden. Kevin Lujano. Leslie Evelyn Torres. Tamson Mora. Paulina Timchenko. Ashley Navarette. Lydia Magdy Hanna. Anna Morris. Rachel Filgus. Isaac Davidson Stanton. Ernest Lamont Banks. Selwyn Quentin Backus II. Armand John Amiri. Robert Maxwell Metz. John Michael Scott. Aloel Devasa. That lolt. Colt Malloy. Mitchell Wilmarth. Jackson Alexander Powell. This spelled right?
Yeah, I hope so.
Caleb Bertels. Colton Latimer. Yeah. Brendan Wolchin. Daniel Lane Matthews. Jaceel Akins. Claudia Leticia Contreras. Ashley Elizabeth Evans. Mason Getters. Jeremiah Hill. Christopher Glendo. Kyle Bozeman Adams. Radisha Russell. Riley Alexandra Davis. Peter Slowick. Kyle Zachary Beard. What the hell's what I said? Chase Howell Wyatt. Patty Gorgie. I'm not going to let you go. Elsie Marie Anderson. Michelle Mace. Evan John McMinn. Natalia Botero Hiller. Bailey Suzanne Bevins. Megan Flynn. Taylor Capri Trantham. Nathaniel Villasana. Jack Harris. Christopher Waring McCall.
Degrees conferred, degrees awarded. A round of applause from all sides. Thank you. Stray thoughts, enthusiasms, keep it coming, folks. It's a big day here. participatory democracy. Everyone has a voice. And perhaps our speaker is emblematic of that. Our commencement speaker this afternoon is a 2011 alumnus from the Bachelor of Landscape Architecture program. While he was a student here at the University of Arkansas, he was also president of the Associated Student Government. Billy Fleming went on from his undergraduate work here to a master's degree at the University of Texas, Austin, took time out, although I hesitate to say that entirely, took time out to serve as a White House fellow in the Obama administration working in urban policy development, the White House Domestic Policy Council. He completed his education, at least thus far, with a doctorate at the University of Pennsylvania in Penn Design. He is currently the Wilkes Family Director for the Ian L. McCarg Center for Urbanism and Ecology at the University of Pennsylvania, which has now been gifted and named the Stuart Weitzman School of Design. Most recently, Billy has authored or co-authored The Indivisible Guide, a progressive grassroots organization with more than 6,000 groups nationwide, and co-created Data Refuge, an international consortium of scientists, librarians, and programmers working to preserve vital economic data at the risk currently of erasure. Before coming to Penn Design, Billy has written extensively in the Atlantic City Lab, The Guardian, the Houston Chronicle, Landscape Journal, Places Journal, and LA Plus, among others. He's a co-editor of the book Design with Nature, Design with Nature Now, published this year, and co-curator of accompanying exhibitions. He's also the author of a book entitled, or a forthcoming book entitled, Drowning America, The Nature and Politics of Adaptation. 2011 alumnus of the Fay Jones School, growing up in Fort Smith, Arkansas, from within a, as Billy would say, a rural working class family. This brings us all back to the roots of the school and its mission, both 70-some years ago, as well as into the next 70 years. I invited Billy here to perhaps challenge us all, certainly to challenge our graduates, as to the work to be done and the work that lies ahead. Billy Fleming.
Thank you very much, Peter. I want to thank everybody for having me and indulging me for a few minutes. I'm going to be really quick because today is really not about anything Peter just said about me or about anything I'm going to say. It's about the folks on stage and the folks in this room who got them here. So I want to say really quickly, my parents did not sneak in here. They were thinking about it. But if they had come here, they'd be in the back with all what sounds like the fun rowdy people who started celebrating this morning. And if you're like my parents, and the administrators can like plug their ears for a second, you maybe brought some of that celebration into the room with you. You're much slyer than they were at my graduation, where every time there was a moment of silence, you could hear like my dad crack a beer. So, you know, now that I'm gone, I can admit to stuff like that. So let me just begin by congratulating all of you on this incredible accomplishment. I don't know if it feels like that for you yet, and it took a while for it to sink in for me when I finished here. But this is a really monumental day for you and your families and for everybody in this room, and especially for the state of Arkansas, where, you know, as many as 4 in 5 people will never get the chance to come to a room like this to receive a degree like the one you've all received. And so I just want to congratulate all of you on that and thank everyone who got you here. I should admit, too, I was never really sure what to say at a commencement speech when Peter invited me. I recalled most of the ones I'd been to being quite bad. And thought this felt kind of like a trap. And the only thing I hope that's the same from my time at commencement here however many years ago and today is that I see Marlon over there also still not wearing a garment or a robe. And so, let me see. So there are a couple things I just want to talk about for today. Because I don't want to get into my CV or any of the stuff that Peter just laid out for you. I want to talk about the way that people wind up at a place like this and at a place like Penn where I am now. And if I leave you with no other thing today, it's that there's no right way to build your career in this field. I don't have any like specific advice or things that happened in my life that are going to be helpful for you. I just want you to make sure that while you relish today, you also recognize how many people made today possible for you. And remember that everything we do in this life, in this profession, is a product of many, many, many people's labor and love and efforts. And that won't stop being true when you leave here. The things that Peter ticked off for me, none of those were possible because of anything I did. It's mostly because I've been surrounded by really smart people for my entire life. And I'll begin kind of with, you know, growing up in Fort Smith. So Peter mentioned this. I grew up in a working class family in Fort Smith. My parents are not from Arkansas. They moved here for a lot of reasons in the early 80s. And I watched them, my brother and sister, and I watched them work 3 and 4 jobs apiece growing up. Nobody in my family had gone to college. There was no plan for anybody in our family to go to college. And even though my parents knew it was really important for their kids to go, and they made sure we knew it was important to go, there was no plan. There was no money set aside for tuition or even SAT prep or any of those kinds of things. And so when I was 16, I used to be in much better shape. And I played baseball and started getting recruited to play baseball at certain places. One of those was West Point. And it became pretty clear pretty quickly that that's where I might end up. For lots of reasons, it's a great school. This was, you know, early 2000s, so this is right after 9/11. And I got a chance to play baseball and a chance to actually make a little bit of money that I could send home to my parents. And for folks who know what it's like to grow up in a house where nobody owns a home, nobody's been to college, you're working 3 and 4 jobs apiece just to get by, every dollar you bring in is shared in the family. It still works that way for us. And so for me, it was an opportunity to get to go to a great school, get to play a sport I love, and get to be able to help a little bit with my family. And as you probably deduced, I did not finish at West Point. Anybody who knew me at that point or knew me after, and I can see Carl Smith over there smirking at me, I was a terrible cadet. And this is probably true for most people who wind up in this field, hated the rules. I hated having to shave my head every 2 weeks. There were lots of things I did not like about it. It was a great place, but just not the right place for me. And so I came back to Arkansas, and I came back for a lot of reasons. One of those is that my parents had managed while I was gone to be able to buy their first house. And this is now in the mid-2000s, and they're in that first wave of homeowners who are about to lose their homes as the recession hits and the housing market collapses. And I took a year off of school to go work a couple jobs and help them keep their house. But as I was doing that, they lost everything else. So they get to keep the house, but we have to sit there, my brother and sister and I do, while everything else in their life is taken from them. We had the sheriff at the door every couple weeks with a credit card judgment. We had bill collectors calling the house 14 hours a day. And it was really the first moment in my life where I remember seeing my parents as human and vulnerable, and just like everybody else, just fumbling through this thing, trying to make it all work. And that pain became really acute and visceral for us at that moment. And I remember, you know, how hard it was to see them struggle that way. And as they're figuring out they can keep the house, and as I'm figuring out I'm going to come back to school, I happen to meet Melinda Smith, who I don't know where she is, if she's around here, who convinced me to take a landscape architecture studio when I came back, which is a thing I loved and never gave up, obviously. But I remember coming back here and being convinced by her, and then being mentored by folks like Carl, who's over there. You can wave your hand if you want, Carl, or not, yeah. And Judy Brittenham, and so many other folks in this school, and so many other folks at this university who pushed me to finish at this place when I never thought that I could. And I don't talk about this a lot, but as I was a student here the first 2 or 3 years and doing studio work and doing classes full-time, I was also working full-time. So I had 40-hour a week job waiting tables off campus, tending bar. And there were many times where I thought about just quitting and going back to the route that my parents and my siblings now have gone, which was to never finish college. And not that there's anything wrong with not finishing college, but I never felt so much guilt and shame as when I thought about doing that, and realizing how much my parents and my family and my mentors here had given up so that I could have a chance to come to a stage like this, first as a student and then to be invited back here to talk with all of you today. And I bring all this up because, not because like anything about that story is particularly unique. One of the things I've learned as I've left here is that actually that story is very, very common in this country. There are so many people who are quietly struggling with so many things we don't understand. But I bring it up because in our fields in particular, but in life in general, there's this impulse to put a very polished image of ourselves and our projects out there in the world. I think fake it till you make it is kind of the term that gets thrown around. And to trade in this myth that there's some individual exceptionalism about me or any of you on this stage that separates us from our peers, separates us from the rest of the world. And I don't know a whole lot. I mean, I guess I shouldn't. My dissertation committee's not here, so I can admit this. I don't know a whole lot. But I know that that's not true. And I want you to remember when you're struggling that there are so many other folks who are struggling with you, and that there's real power in finding ways to build community around that struggle and to get through things together. You've all clearly done that because you're on this stage, but I want you to remember the folks who come after you, too, as you leave. I mentioned this earlier. You know, a defining characteristic of my life is that I've been surrounded by very generous and supportive people and really smart and collaborative people. And there's no way I would have ever gone from, you know, nearly being evicted with my parents in Fort Smith to this place, to the White House with the Obama administration, to the University of Pennsylvania and everything else in between without all the folks who made that possible. And so I want to ask our grads to indulge me in something for a second. We grew up in Fort Smith. My mom is Jewish, and I think it made her like the only Jewish person in Fort Smith. And my dad is Catholic, and so it meant that I also like harbored tons of guilt about myself all the time. But it also meant I got really used to like sitting and standing and kneeling and sitting and standing. So I'm going to ask all of you, all the graduates, to please stand up for a moment and just indulge me. And as they're standing, I want, you know, for folks in the crowd who are able, if you have a child on stage or a grandchild, please stand up. If you have a sibling or a cousin or a friend on stage, please stand up. If I did not cover you and you're in the crowd, please stand up. I want to ask our graduates to thank everybody out here for helping them get here today. I'm gonna do my best mass impersonation and tell you to sit. Now, if I were smart, I would have probably ended it there, and I promise I'm almost done since I made you give me a standing ovation. But I want to say one more thing about what happens after today, because you're all going to go on to do incredible things, and I hope you tell me about them and you tell the rest of the school about them, selfishly because I want to recruit more of you to Penn for grad school, but also because the work you do is incredible and should be highlighted. I spend a lot of my time these days thinking about the 1960s and 70s. Partially because the group that I run at Penn is preparing to mark a 50th anniversary of Ian McCarg's sort of canonical book, but also because that's the last time, it's really the first time in this country, that we saw a huge coordinated push around the environment actually succeed and get realized through Congress. And I spent a lot of time thinking about that anniversary because, you know, that era, which has now been called the environmental decade of the 70s, was led by young people. It was led by people in college and right out of college, people who chose professions purposely around the environment, people who chose what to do with their lives outside of their professions around the environment. And whether you listen to, you know, the United Nations, IPCC, the U.S. Department of Defense and Armed Services, or the Pope, they all agree that the most urgent issue facing us is climate change. And that's this generation's environmental crisis. And it may feel like you're going to be able to do projects in your life that don't intersect with that at all. And I can also tell you the only other thing I know is that's also not true. Every project you take on, every act you take on outside of your office is going to touch on that issue. It's going to shape the rest of your lives. And your choice now is to figure out where and how you take that cause up. Not if, because that choice has been made for you by your parents and grandparents who are here. And I don't care if you're going to work with farmers in the Delta. I don't care if you're going to work with real estate developers in Singapore. And I don't care if you're going to work with anybody else in any city or community on this planet. We've designed ourselves into this situation, and we're going to have to design our way out of it. So with that, I want to congratulate all of you again. And I would want to just remind you to take other people with you as you leave this place. We should have twice this number on this stage in a few years. So thank you.
Thank you, Billy. You represent our alumni and their impact out in the world. You may want to be self-deprecating about it, which I respect, but you are nonetheless a representative of the impact that our graduates can have upon the world, and I commend you for the work that you are doing. Billy mentioned a member of our staff who had impact upon his life, Melinda Smith, who serves as our Director of Student Affairs. We are privileged in this school to have what I regard as the finest staff across the university. And I would hope that they would be willing to come forward or otherwise stand up if they are anywhere in the room, backstage. If you can hear me, they have perhaps moved elsewhere. Please come forward, Teresa Perry. Sometimes we have one staff member in the school who does everything, right? Teresa Parrish. No. We work lean and we work hard, but we work effectively and with great affection. I think the students understand that. I know the faculty appreciate that. But this event today, of course, has come together by the efforts of many of our staff across the school. Lane Schmidt, Elizabeth Tetley, Michelle Parks, Shania Myers, Cassidy Flanagan, Mary Purvis, Ryan Peters, Melinda Smith, Judy Stone, Sherry Lynn Brown, Teresa Parrish, Ainsley Higginbotham. Yes? Yes. These are great and good people who very often go unrecognized, do not seek that recognition, but deserve our recognition today. Please give them a round of applause wherever they are. We're close, and I do want to remind everyone that there is maybe not quite the effervescence that Billy would want us to have, but certainly refreshments that await us all in the second floor gallery of the Stephen L. Anderson Design Center in Fall Walker Hall. But before we get there, I want to come back to 1969. And I was talking with our chancellor and with John Dupree before we came out about that year. In 1969, in Woodstock, Jimi Hendrix played one of the most distinctive, memorable versions of the Star Spangled Banner ever at dawn in the morning. And you may think of that as perhaps being disrespectful. I have watched that film over and over and over again, and I see it as an ultimate act of affection for this country. We all express our affection for this country in different ways, but we are able to do so because we live in this country. In 1969, Richard Nixon was the President of the United States. Golda Meir was the first woman to be premier in Israel. Samuel Beckett won the Nobel Prize for Literature, The Godfather was published, Monty Python was released on the BBC for the first time. I don't propose these as complementary pairs or even as causal sequences of events, but to suggest that this was a year which still has relevance to who and what we are now. ARPANET, which was in fact the forerunner of the internet, was first explored in 1969, the first automatic teller machine was opened in Rochester, New York. Boeing flew its first 747 flight in 1969, and yes, on July 20th, 1969, Apollo 11 landed on the moon. Landed on the moon! Right. Student protests ran across the country from Cambridge, Massachusetts, to Berkeley, California, to everywhere in between. And at the same time, many, many people, men and women, served in the war in Vietnam and lost their lives or came home otherwise transformed. The first troop withdrawals began in 1969. Peace negotiations began secretly in Paris in 1969, and yet all those born on September 14th between 1944 and 1951 were going to be called up for the draft. Contradictions, paradoxes, relationships. The Cuyahoga River caught on fire. There was a massive oil spill off of the coast of Santa Barbara. Both of those events bring forward, for instance, the Environmental Protection Agency and ultimately lead to the first Earth Day in 1970. There was rioting outside the Stonewall Tavern on the Lower East Side of New York, which ultimately leads to a gay rights movement which still has relevance today. And Hurricane Camille, the largest, most powerful hurricane to ever hit, make landfall in this nation's history, did so to devastating effect. And Walmart incorporated itself. The Beatles walked across Abbey Road. Elvis went back into the recording studio in Memphis. And Aretha Franklin recorded Chain of Fools. So what does that mean for us now? I'm sure those who graduated in 1969 reflect upon that periodically. It means, perhaps, to echo Billy Fleming's words, that we are still living with these issues, that there is still work to do. There is work to do in understanding technology wisely. There is work to do in understanding our society and working on behalf of others less privileged, less advantaged, wisely. There is work to do in the environment, perhaps more than ever, and we need to act wisely. Billy suggested that for him, in some small measure, it begins with his family, it begins with his education, it continues on into other callings and other purposes. That's what this day is about. It's not that everything starts here, but everything certainly hinges from here. And I would ask us all to recognize the impact that we have on each other's lives, to recognize the impact that we must begin having in the environment, in the worlds of technology, in our society. And if it sounds somewhat banal, I hope an earlier event that we celebrated today, the love that we possess for each other, continues to bind us all together and to animate what we do. There is no other reason for doing what we do in design than hope and the belief that at very least we can improve each other's lives, even temporarily here amongst each other. That's my hope. That is my hope for our graduates. And it is born, I will say, out of what I heard in part from Chris Hinton Lee earlier today. She spoke about growing up in a family where the word can't was taboo. You could not say in her family that you cannot do that, you can't succeed, you can't go forward. She spoke to the values of optimism, perseverance, resiliency, and absolute fearlessness. And that is what I hope for you as you go forward in your lives. Remain optimistic, remain perseverant, remain fearless. Be resilient as you produce resiliency for others. That's the example of our alumni, Billy, Chris Hinton Lee. It's the example of our faculty in all their hopes for you as well. And I want to thank you for having the privilege of working with you over these last 5 years, and I look forward to your return to us as alumni, as faculty, as, in a sense, the gifts that you have been for these last 5 years. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll meet again in a few minutes in the Vol Walker Hall and in the Stephen L. Anderson Design Center, but before we do so, please join me in congratulating the Fay Jones School of Architecture and Design Class of 2019. Loud huzzah. Now, one last encore here, or if it's not an encore, it's simply a one more event. In 1969, on May 11th, the number one song, Top 40, Casey Kasem announcing, will be our recessional today. I'm giving you 5 seconds to think what that number one song on May 11, 1969 was, because we will be marching out to that song. May I have that queued up and ready to go? Press play. Come on, everybody. Come on, everybody. Get your hands up.
Get it.